I'm delighted that we have our third speaker on this very, very important theme of new directions in participatory democracy. Our speaker is Powys Whyte of Michigan State University, and he's going to introduce both himself a little bit further and also his topic, and then talk for about 20 minutes, followed by discussion. And I hope everybody has what to eat and drink as you listen to this fantastic outside speaker.
Hi. Okay,
thank you for coming.
Very familiar with the Midtown Tunnel now after
Yes, I spent so much time in it. That's right. I know about every single tile.
And you have a great background, Kyle, by the way.
Oh, I see.
Yes,
good.
That's
okay.
What we planned. Yeah. We put it right there.
Yeah, I mean, I have to say this is probably the most interesting speaking situation that I've ever been in.
Interesting is polite.
Right. but I think we did our best. Yeah, no, I apologize for being late. It was just a flight situation. It was like one of those days during the year when, you know, all of the airports, I think in New York City, was it all of them that,
yeah,
had,
yeah,
that shut down
delay
for a while? Yeah. What's that?
5 hour delay.
Yeah, 5 hour delay, and then it set, you know, everybody else, you know, so I was sitting in Detroit and things like that and wondering what time I would get in, but I actually made it pretty good. I think I eventually got in a cab at about 5:30 and sort of got through the tunnel and traffic and made it here a little bit after 6 o'clock. So anyway, so I'm Kyle Whyte and I'm assistant professor in the philosophy department at Michigan State University, and I've been there for about 5 years. And the primary area that I work on are climate justice, environmental justice issues with respect to Indigenous peoples, and so I've been doing a number of publishing projects and activist projects as well, trying to be an advocate for improving the ways in which Indigenous people, especially North America, are empowered to adapt to climate change. I also work a little bit on climate change mitigation as well, but I'm part of a lot of different policy groups, and I work with a lot of different organizations that are trying to change U.S. and also Canadian policy so that it's more amenable to Indigenous people's concerns with respect to climate change. So what I wanted to do in the talk today, since there's this theme of deliberative democracy, is I wanted to share some ideas about what the notion of deliberative democracy can look like from certain Indigenous perspectives. And I wanted to then talk about how climate change is forcing a lot of us that work in Indigenous contexts to begin to think differently about what deliberative democracy would mean, you know, with the sorts of impacts associated with climate change. So I thought that I might be in a situation of doing a short talk like this, so I made some notes instead of my PowerPoint. So I might at a few, you know, times kind of look like I have a PowerPoint, right? Kind of like a phantom presentation. And please interrupt, and you know, please don't be shy with respect to the refreshments if you run out during my 10 or 20 minute talk. So first of all, the concept I wanted to start off is that so when I refer to Indigenous people, what sorts of folks am I referring to? So in my work generally, Indigenous people refer to the roughly 370 million people in the world who, you know, generally consider themselves to have governed themselves before an ongoing or historical period of colonization or invasion, and their systems of governance came out of a different sort of cosmology, a different worldview than are often associated with the dominant forms of governance that you see in the world today, such as the U.S. federal government. And Indigenous people are extremely diverse, and that definition I just gave of Indigenous people is also one that some people who would seem to fit that notion actually don't want to be called that, or there's some people that want to be called that, but they don't really fit the notion. So Indigenous people for me really refers to a concept that's built a lot of steam in the 1970s when groups of people who did govern themselves prior to invasion or a period of colonization tried to form an international movement that's actually been very successful in influencing international policy. So, you know, Indigenous people isn't necessarily a term where you get sort of a precise reference, but it's a term that lots of different people use. And in my work generally, I work with federally recognized tribes in the U.S. context, and it also spills over into Canada as well. So a lot of the things that I say apply very much in certain North American contexts, elsewhere as well. But there's other contexts where, if someone heard what I was talking about, they would say that's not what Indigenous people deal with in this other part of the world. So to begin with, that's kind of how I understand the notion of Indigenous people. Now, when we get into these issues of deliberative democracy. So this is where we get sort of one difference that I wanted to start off with. So if we look at like one aspect of deliberative democracy, which is, how is it that people's voices are heard within political processes? For Indigenous people, one of the key things in my work that I deal with is that they don't want to deal with questions of deliberative democracy as stakeholders or as ordinary citizens of a nation state like the U.S. So actually, when we talk about deliberative democracy in a lot of Indigenous peoples context like that I work in, it's not the idea of how is it that Indigenous people as citizens of larger nation states get to participate in political processes, but how is it that Indigenous people as members of sort of sovereign enclaves within nation states participate as representatives of those governments. So already I think when you look at issues of deliberation, and in one of the research projects I'm part of that's funded by the Fish and Wildlife Service, we interviewed over 40 different Indigenous cooperative groups on natural resource management in the Great Lakes area, and all of them said that on questions of deliberation, I mean, they didn't use that term, they were more using terms of in interactions with federal agencies, but what they meant is in situations where you have to work across the table with somebody else, you have to make your voice heard. It's key that the U.S. federal government doesn't consider Native people as citizens of the U.S., but as members of separate nations, as sovereigns. So one thing to note is that the context that I work in, if you talk about a sort of a concept like deliberative democracy, you're actually not talking about how Indigenous people would participate as citizens, but you're actually talking about structures that Indigenous people see as joint governance structures. So that there's a whole area, I think, that a lot of philosophers would call deliberative democracy, but in sort of Indigenous studies, we might, it's the same conversation in a lot of respects, but we call it sort of joint governance. And so any opportunity for Native peoples in North America to work with federal agencies, with the state, with NGOs, occur within these joint governance structures, right, where Indigenous people are considered to be members of or representatives of sovereign enclaves within larger nation states. Now, what are these joint governance structures in which deliberation occurs? So when is it that Indigenous people involve themselves in deliberation within a nation-state context in the U.S.? And this is where I think there's some interesting things to point out. So for example, one very common form of a joint governance structure is a treaty. So how exactly does a treaty work? And this is where we get a particular tricky issue. If you're not used to talking about Indigenous issues, that oftentimes you sort of miss some of the nuances. Well, in the United States context, for example, treaties were signed in the 19th century. The U.S. stopped signing treaties in 1874. And when Native people and the federal government came and put together the treaty, the federal government often saw the treaty as a document that vouched for limiting Indigenous people's rights to certain areas. So they saw it as a document that actually placed limits, and it actually aspired to a form of certainty, right? The U.S. wanted it to actually sort of draw the line between where Indigenous people could be and where the U.S. government or state governments, or in the case of Canada, provincial governments could be, and their residents as well. But a lot of Indigenous people in the treaty period, I actually understood the treaty as just sort of initial documents that were supposed to guide evolving relationships that would have a kind of flexibility to them. So the idea was that for a lot of Native species, so taken in the Great Lakes, lots of Ojibwe people who I work with, I'm also a member of a Anishinaabe nation of which Ojibwe is one of the groups. There are certain species that are extremely important for these nations in the Great Lakes for their subsistence lifestyles. And one of the things, as you guys know, is that ecosystems can be unpredictable. So you want to be, if you're dependent on a certain species, you want to be able to follow that species into different places that it goes. So in the treaty period, a lot of indigenous people understood the treaty as basically establishing an evolving relationship. So if something like a species shift would occur, that relationship would allow for a kind of flexibility that would make it so the U.S. government would continue to support indigenous subsistence regarding that species, even in an area that might not have been designated within the treaty itself. So this is one example of a joint governance structure. Another example of a joint governance structure is, here in the United States, we call it the federal trust relationship. So this goes back to a number of court cases in the 19th century that were deeply paternalistic, where the United States essentially saw that native people were kind of its wards, and you know, it was supposed to treat them like children. But native people actually often saw this idea of the trust relationship as the initiation of a relationship between sort of a larger power and a smaller power, right? So today the trust relationship refers to this idea that in native affairs, the federal government actually has to look out for the best interests of Indian tribes, right? So in you see numerous policies then, right, of joint governance that talks about sort of the duties of the federal government and the duties of indigenous people within the trust relationship. And while historically the federal government saw that as a paternalistic relationship, a lot of native people entered into this relationship thinking it was a form of coexistence between two very different kinds of powers, not necessarily one that knew better than the other. So in talking about these joint governance instruments, and there's many, many more I could talk about, you know, in joint management boards in Canada, treatment of state status in the United States, you know, treaty organizations. Well, I might say a few things about that. But the thing to note about these joint governance institutions is that they all started with sort of the colonial interests of countries like the U.S. So they all just have, you know, crappy reasons for existing in the first place. But Native people understood them differently, right? And so Native people have worked for a long, long time to try to make these institutions amenable to their particular concerns. And one of the key concepts that, or not concepts, but sort of one of the key kind of ideas that I work with is if you look at today, right, something like a treaty, right, you'll see that Native people have completely increased their power to work across the table with federal agencies, right? So a treaty right now, and in New York this is a big deal, as in other parts of the Great Lakes, right? A lot of tribes are represented by treaty organizations. Treaty organizations have ginormous scientific staff, they have legal staff, they have policy staff, and these treaty organizations try to negotiate with the states, the provinces, the federal governments, in order to protect tribal subsistence lifestyles, to protect unique tribal systems of governance, right? And while the United States actually might understand a treaty organization simply as a mechanism for conflict resolution, you know, or a mechanism for making sure that tribes don't step beyond the bounds that the treaty demarcates as the limits of where indigenous people can engage in their lifestyles, indigenous people understand the treaty much differently. So if you look at cases of deliberation, and you know, in another presentation I could go into more detail as to actually how those sorts of deliberations occur, that's what I study primarily, but sort of at a higher level of abstraction, right, that deliberation, the involvement of Native people in American political processes occurs within these joint governance contexts, where you have players like a treaty organization, where you have players like a tribal government that are working within these joint governance institutions, and are institutions that both parties see very differently. They see them as very different purposes. And this is why, for a lot of Native people, they've been able to use things like treaties, is because even though the U.S. doesn't necessarily recognize a treaty in the same way that a tribe does, tribes know that there are certain bounds in which they can use the treaty to protect their lifestyles without actually having to change what the U.S. thinks about the treaty. So there's kind of it's a form of diplomacy that you see a lot of indigenous people engaging in within these joint governance instruments, is that they know that the U.S. government likely always see a treaty as a limitation. But within that limitation, you can engage in a whole range of agencies that then allow what the U.S. government otherwise sees as something that you don't like very much, as something that can actually empower your own community. And so in deliberative context, these are the kinds of conversations that you see across the table among Indigenous people, federal agencies, state agencies, organizations, and so on. So one of the philosophical issues, just to mention, though it's not my main point, is that you might be thinking that given these joint governance institutions have these sort of bad pasts in colonialism and so on, who then are the Indigenous participants themselves within these joint governance instruments? And that's actually a pretty valid philosophical question that I actually wanted to mention, right? Because say for a tribe in the United States, who is its rightful government? Is it a government that has continued to exist since time immemorial, and the current people that occupy that government, they are the sort of descendants of those different forms of governance of that government? Or is it the government that the United States helped to create in the 1930s when they were trying to find a way to facilitate tribal involvement with extraction industries? So they created a democratically elected government. And so the 565 federally recognized tribes today have these democratically elected governments, which are also legitimate in a certain sense, right? Is that the proper delegation? There's also organizations, Indigenous activists, and so on, that also claim to be representing the cultural notion of governance of their tribal people that also enter into these discussions as well. Or in the case of treaties, at the treaty organization, right, which is vested in a certain power based on court cases that were settled in the 70s and 80s, right? So who are the Indigenous delegations that ought to represent different tribal groups in these sort of joint governance deliberative contexts? But so this is something that...
Are you going to answer the question?
What's that?
Are you going to answer that question?
am I on camera?
Yes.
No.
But you have the right to edit it.
No, I'm just joking. No, but it's actually, it's not a question that can be answered in terms of it's one group over the other, because each of these groups, and there's more that I didn't mention, has a form of legitimacy, and oftentimes people will judge one of them very harshly. Like, they're going to say, oh, the democratically elected tribal government, well, that's just illegitimate because it came out of, you know, a 1930s policy by the United States government, and a lot of tribes didn't have democratically elected governments originally. But actually, most of the people I work with are in tribal governments, and they do represent a lot of community members, and they do things that are, you know, supportive of the tribe's interests, right? They're not sort of things that are solely driven by the United States government. In fact, they're pretty much the opposite of that in a lot of respects, despite their origin. But modern tribal governments actually are another example of these joint governance institutions. You know, so for example, one of the current policies that a lot of tribes make a lot of use of in the United States, and there are some equivalents in other parts of the world, but in the U.S., right, you have a system in environmental law called cooperative federalism, and it's in other aspects of law as well, where the federal government sets, say, air quality standards, and then it's the state's responsibility to take over that program. And the state takes it over, it gets certain advantages, like California can set higher air quality standards, or you can, if you're governing landfills, you can use materials that are more cost effective if you take over your own program. Now, tribes can participate that. They can be considered states, so they can take over federal programs and apply higher standards for those programs in order to protect things like religious uses of water. So here you'll have a tribal government that's using a state structure as determined by, say, the Environmental Protection Agency or the Forest Service or another agency, using that structure to then set standards that ultimately affect things that tribal members are concerned about, but U.S. citizens living around the tribe maybe aren't that concerned about, right? So there you have another one of these joint governance structures as well. And these are where deliberations occur, right? So to handle a dispute over water quality standards, you'll have the tribal government that's recognized as a state. That's not the whole tribe, it's just that democratically elected government. Whatever Environmental Protection Agency or Natural Resource Agency it's developed, the scientists within that, the state that's next to it, the county, the federal government, you have all these people at the table. But when you think about, well, what's the nature of that deliberation? Tribes want to understand themselves as not just stakeholders in the, you know, the sense of people living in next county, but as actual separate governments, right? But that actual conversation, and this is the point I started with, but that actual conversation, you have to understand that it's occurring within these particular joint governance structures. So you can't sort of just consider, okay, well, how does the tribal voice express itself in deliberation? You have to consider, well, what is the larger joint governance structure it fits into? So that's sort of a an introduction to at least just one way or one particular angle of thinking about deliberative democracy in Indigenous peoples' contexts. Now, I want to focus a little bit on the environment. And one of the key things for tribes, as you probably gleaned from other things I said, is environmental protection. So for a lot of tribes, and I just wanted to focus on this very, very quickly, but for a lot of tribes, they see their own system of governance as very, very different from the one that the U.S. does. So for example, a collaborator of mine, we published an article, but then also he has a article he published in to make a pair that talk about Indigenous deer hunting governance systems, right? So here the idea is that in a particular Ojibwe tribe in Wisconsin, where he did interviews, they were managing deer hunting, and then the state of Wisconsin was also managing deer hunting. Now, the state of Wisconsin manages deer hunting very differently. They have a permitting system and, you know, certain short seasons and fines and bag limits and all sorts of things. Now, the tribe does it very differently, right? But both systems actually are attempting to manage the deer population in a way that keeps the ecosystem in a certain condition felt to be desirable. The tribal system doesn't use the same kind of permitting system. It's largely a family-based system that's based on moral education and based on family relationships and not based on a certain sorts of restrictions that you see in the state, right? And it's also a system based on sharing among the community. So in the two studies that we did, one in which I was an author, the other in which him and someone else did, we sort of looked and said, well, actually, the tribal system of governance is pretty good. The state system is pretty good. The tribal system is pretty good for regulating, stewarding the deer population. But the idea there I just want to express is that the tribal system of governance operated very different as a family-based system. It wasn't sort of a top-down isn't quite the right word here, but it wasn't the same as the state system. So when people talk about environmental protection in Indian country, what they're oftentimes talking about, to connect what I was just talking about before, is, say, protecting the ecosystem involved in, say, the deer population, right? Because the deer population is needed for that system of governance to flourish, right? So when people talk about environmental protection in Indian country, it's not just really talking about, say, pollution in water that would cause a certain health outcome. It's actually talking about protecting the environmental quality. So that environmental quality is the right one that needs to be the case for Indigenous governance systems to actually operate. Indigenous governance systems that heavily involve certain relationship with different species, with different aspects of the environment. So this is one notion, right? So we're talking about environmental protection in Indian country. We're not just talking about protection against health hazards, right? In fact, in cases where tribes are particularly worried about health hazards, like, say, pollution in fish, right, issues of mercury, one of the concerns that comes out is that a lot of toxicologists think that if they just identify what fish have the most toxicity, right, and tell Indians not to eat those fish, then that's the best form of advice. Where all Native people think that's very bad advice, because the whole idea is if you don't eat those fish, and those are traditional fish, then your whole economy collapses, your whole governance system collapses, along with the family relationships, the social relationships, the intergenerational relationships that go into your interactions with that fish population. And it's not to actually argue that these governance systems are, necessarily better or worse than any other. I'm not engaging in that debate in this particular talk. But it is just the idea that we're talking about environmental protection in Indian country. We're not just talking about preserving environmental quality, but in preserving environmental quality requisite for a certain kind of governance, which is considered to differ from the governance system of, say, a dominant nation like the United States that surrounds a tribe like Ojibwe or, here in New York, Haudenosaunee, different Haudenosaunee groups. So I have a concept. I mean, it's not really a concept, but it's just the way that I talk about.
You're allowed to have concepts here.
I'm allowed to have concepts.
Yeah, at least as far as I'm concerned. I don't know.
Okay.
CUNY, but.
Yeah, I'm too used to speaking to people in the federal agencies and stuff like
that. No, we like concepts.
Yeah, no, okay. But so what I've talked about, so in the literature on institutions of environmental protection, there is this concept called FIT. And the notion of FIT kind of works like this. You'll have to draw a few connections here between stuff I was saying before. But so just not thinking about Indigenous people at all, what does it mean for an institution to fit the ecosystem that it's supposed to manage, right? So take, for example, a state Department of Natural Resources that's responsible for managing a certain population, say deer or a certain kind of fowl or something like that, right? Well, if that agency is just limited to the state boundaries, so the state boundaries of Michigan or New York or Rhode Island or something like that, that the species that it's supposed to steward doesn't care about those boundaries. Those boundaries were not created with a certain ecosystem in mind. So there's a whole literature that talks about how institutions like, say, a state Department of Natural Resources that seek to manage or steward a certain species, if they're using designs that weren't taking into consideration the nature of the ecosystem, so say they're limited by these arbitrary political boundaries, arbitrary in an environmental sense, or if they're ones that only, say, include one form of science for tracking the species, but not other forms of science, like, say, ecology or something like that, then these institutions don't fit their ecosystem well. So in environmental protection or environmental management literature, there's this idea that we need to sort of redesign these institutions that protect environmental quality to fit the ecosystems, that ecosystems don't operate according to human political rules or human social rules, right? So it's a push to really transform the nature of institutions. Now, for
adaptive management,
right? So yeah, FIT is a notion that is part of the family of adaptive management approaches. Yes, absolutely. but within a notion of these notions of adaptive management or FIT, so Indigenous people are involved in FIT as well, but they're involved in a special kind of FIT, actually, because going back to those joint governance institutions I'm talking about, so Indigenous people have these institutions that they inherited from colonial times, like the tribal government, or treaty rights, or the federal trust relationship, and so on. And these institutions, none of them fit the dynamics of an ecosystem at all. A treaty does not fit the dynamic of an ecosystem. So one thing that tribes have to do is they have to try to do things that make the treaty system fit the ecosystem, right? But at the same time, when they're engaged in that process of fitting, they're also engaged in what is usually referred to as orientation, which is that they have to make sure that at the same time that that institution is being crafted to fit the ecosystem, that it's also at the same time fitting the tribal conception of governance, right? So the tribal understanding of what the ecosystem is, right? Based on a tribal cosmology, like that governance system I was telling you about with respect to deer. But if the institution favors a tribal system, then it won't be respected by, say, the U.S. federal government or the state whose DNR it is, or whoever it is, right? So tribes are involved in this very complicated process where you're not just trying to take these institutions that you've inherited and trying to fit them to the ecosystem, you're also trying to make sure that in your processes of fitting that you are creating institutional structures that allow your own system of governance to be supported by that institution, but not in a way where the U.S. government gets upset about that. And then we get another sort of 1970s fishing war, 1970s resource war, or something like that, right? So this is a process that I call that I call orientation. It's a process that Indigenous people are involved in for the sake of environmental protection, right? Now, so one of the things that's occurred, and this is where issues, I think, of climate change are important, is that there's just a huge literature that tells you all about the things I've just been telling you about now. It tells you all about how deliberation occurs within these joint government institutions, and it talks about how tribes have oriented them to serve tribal needs, right? So there's a huge literature talking about how tribes have done amazing things with treaty rights. But every time that tribes have done these things, right, they've always had to play off of, say, the U.S. or Canada's interest in using these governance interests to establish some kind of certainty, right? So take, you know, for example, with a treaty right, a lot of tribes can do a lot of things for their own governance systems, their own subsistence systems within a treaty area. But in order to have that kind of leverage or to have that authority respected, they've pretty much had to say that, yeah, these are the bounds of the treaty, right? So that the outside of those areas, the treaty organization or the tribal government has no authority. The U.S. won't respect it, and certainly the states won't respect it. So that if you look, and if I had my PowerPoint slides up, I'd show you all these visuals I have that talk about, you know, it's not a big deal. But you use your imagination, right? I've got treaty areas and reservation areas inside them, and then outside of those treaty areas are places where tribes just can't, have any kind of governance authority whatsoever, right? Within treaty areas, they have governance authority over the environment. Within the reservation area, the tribal governments do. All of this is to say that this whole notion of how these governance institutions work is that the tribes are always having to sort of trade off between conceding a certain fixity or a certain certainty that the U.S. government wants, but then trying to retain a kind of flexibility that allows for coexistence of an indigenous subsistence system within these areas. At least the U.S. or a state will respect that a tribe has the authority to do so. So that if you look then at kind of the history of the development of these different institutions and how they've served tribal needs, you'll see that tribes have made a lot of trade-offs in order to make it so these institutions retained a certain kind of authority in the eyes of the more dominant groups like the U.S. or states or organizations or industry. Now, keeping in mind this idea that I was telling you is that to even understand certain dimensions of deliberation in Indian country or for indigenous people, you have to understand how they occur in these joint governance contexts, right? Climate change then, this is the point that I wanted to make that contributes to the theme of this particular panel. It's more than a panel, right? It's a set of talks or
it will
new
be
direction.
Later.
Okay.
No, ours is a panel.
Okay. So the idea is actually climate change is making pretty drastic alterations to how a lot of indigenous people, especially in North America, think about joint governance, and that in turn has an implication for how we begin to think about deliberation, right? So let me give you a few examples of what I'm talking about, and then I'll flesh out the points a little bit more. So there's a nice literature that's finally emerging that talks about the ways in which indigenous people are impacted by climate change. So a lot of you are probably familiar with the basis of climate change, but simply the idea that the gradual rise in global average temperature is leading to a certain destabilization of the climate system as we know it, and certain patterns that humans expected in their lives and things like that, you know, historically they are changing. You know, so areas that never had to worry about flooding or never had to worry about, you know, urban heat island or urban heat stroke or things like that, that they're now going to get this a lot more frequently, right? Or areas that might have thought they had a really short growing season, well, they got a really long growing season, and it's going to change their economy. Or whole communities might have to relocate due to a number of things, coastal erosion, sea level rise. So, you know, climate change refers to sort of refers to these impacts that we are speculating about in the future that are going to be produced by the destabilization of the climate system. And obviously the other, you know, part of this is that why is the climate system going to be destabilized? And as far as a lot of scientists think today, humans definitely play a role in that destabilization through emissions and through, you know, emissions of greenhouse gases and through deforestation. So indigenous people in particular, and another talk I could talk to you more about, these notions of vulnerability, but indigenous people are considered to be particularly vulnerable to these climate change impacts. Why? Because if you just take an example of something like, flooding or warming or something like that. Societies where you have less money, you have less infrastructure, you have less political respect, you experience harsher conditions, you know, these sorts of impacts are going to be a lot more difficult to endure. And there's numerous other people in the world that are vulnerable, right? In a lot of countries, women are more vulnerable than other members of their societies, minorities, poor people, and so on. So indigenous people fit among the groups that are particularly worried about climate change because they don't think that they're going to be able to absorb climate change impacts without having to face up to pretty serious harms. Now, that's a huge discussion. But one of the things that I've been writing about recently is that these climate change impacts are going to pretty much drastically change how we think in Indian country, in Indigenous contexts, about what it means to work across the table and to engage in joint governance, because a lot of the climate change impacts will be extreme enough that they actually challenge these joint governance institutions. So the joint governance institutions I talk about will be sort of, in a lot of ways, nullified, disoriented by the climate change impacts. So in the brief time I have, I'll tell you about one example, and I'll relate it to having to rethink deliberation in Indigenous context. So for a lot of tribes, right, they've established pretty good governance systems for species that matter to them culturally. Sturgeon, moose, deer populations, wild rice, talking about the Great Lakes. And if you look at how tribes have been able to protect their access to these species, you'll see that they've just used a number of creative techniques for doing so, using treaties, the federal trust responsibility, tribal governments, in international indigenous rights. Right? It's just a whole set of these different joint governance instruments that have been developed over time. But if you look at something like, say, a treaty right, where tribes have traded off this idea that of the certainty of the treaty area, when the species actually moves off of the outside of the treaty area, then tribes actually don't have any governance structures that would be given any kind of credence or authority by the United States, or by the particular state as well, or the particular province, or the communities that live outside of the treaty area. So if a tribe wants to continue to have that relationship, guess what it has to do? It is no longer going to be able to only work with partners that it has historically worked with and developed certain limited but nonetheless all right relationships with, like certain federal agencies. Instead, we'll have to work with towns, certain municipalities, we'll have to work with states or provinces, and historically states have been extremely hostile to tribal interests, right? The federal government oftentimes has to mediate between tribes and states. You'll have to work with private citizens who have never ever worked with tribes, probably didn't even know that there was a tribe living close by, which is a fairly common phenomenon. Organizations, NGOs that never had to engage with tribes before, don't understand what tribal sovereignty is about, don't understand the history of relations with tribes. And so tribes are going to have to enter into deliberative contexts to engage in environmental protection with people who have no understanding of where they're coming from, right? And so these are not deliberations that are guided by these sort of historical governance structures that came out of colonialism, like treaties or the trust responsibilities, but they're entirely open sorts of situations in which tribes have no protection from ignorance, from poor deliberative capacities, from the ill will that these different parties have toward tribes. And so there's a kind of an emerging literature that now talks about how under conditions of climate change, tribes are automatically going to have to engage in more flexible governance instruments or institutions with parties who they've not previously dealt with. And without the authority of something like a treaty or a treatment of state status or something like that, then whether the deliberation goes well depends solely on whether people who haven't understood very much about tribes in the past actually learn a lot about tribal governance, so that they would understand that even though there wasn't a legal right as respected by the nation state that they belong to have access to those species, that they should nonetheless change their own behavior so that a tribe could exercise a foreign governance authority in an area where it previously wasn't considered to have authority. And so climate change then actually, and there's numerous other examples of this, right? So what climate change is actually doing is it's invalidating, it's nullifying, it's disorienting these joint governance instruments that tribes historically have spent years and years trying to orient to serve these different purposes, not only fitting the ecosystem, but also to serve their governance systems in a way of coexistence with very different forms of governance. And it's creating these newer deliberative contexts. And a lot of people want to say, this is an opportunity to create new relationships that tribes never had before. And Well, that is correct in a sense. If you are someone that tracks, you know, sort of how deliberation occurs, how people deal with each other, and if you look at this idea that even though there's some cases that people have been successful, I feel very strongly that it's actually almost like starting over. And it's, yeah.
What language is used in these deliberations? Is it mostly English?
Yeah, it's mostly English, but there's more cases emerging where in these contexts, you know, native languages or tribal ceremonies are being used equally with, you know, Canadian or U.S. Mm-hmm. So there's some cases where that's changing.
And then there's a translator or an interpreter, or.
Yeah, exactly. There's a translator or an interpreter. I mean, one of the things that you get in Indigenous deliberative situations, it's a strange phenomenon, right? Is that, you know, Native people, when they're working with, say, the federal government, they know all about how the federal government works. The federal government knows nothing about how tribes work often, right? So I've been in a lot of meetings where somebody, say, from the Fish and Wildlife Service or the Forest Service, who's trying to sell tribes a program for, you know, landscape scale conservation or something like that, will say, well, I've never heard of treaty rights before. Whereas the tribes in the room know all about how that agency works, right? But it's even more difficult, right, when you're talking about parties like states that typically haven't seen themselves as being delegated with the authority to work with tribes. And climate change then is so circling back to your question, is that, again, is that climate change is actually pushing Indigenous people into a situation where their opportunity to participate in the political processes of, say, a country like the United States is now going to be with parties that they historically don't have very many ties to, which are usually hostile to them. And so things like what you're talking about, where they're, oh, well, can tribes use their own language in those deliberations or ceremonies, I believe that that is going to be less likely in the sorts of deliberative contexts that are going to be needed to negotiate problems like, say, off-treaty area species based on climate change.
Maybe you should take this opportunity to open.
And there's other, I think, we can talk about other things too, not just Indigenous people. I think this is a point that can be made in a lot of for a lot of other groups. But if you at least are committed to the idea that. It's part of our conversation about, you know, deliberation, deliberative democracy, you know, is also a conversation about the governance structures that house those deliberations. Climate change, for a lot of people, is going to actually change those governance structures and will hence probably change the deliberations. And we have reason to be worried with respect to some groups about what deliberation might be like in the future. Yes.
Yeah, I was just going to ask, I mean, you mentioned in this last set of comments or presentation, by the way, your presentation was wonderful. I was amazed how you could talk so fast and yet it was possible to follow you.
Okay.
And you covered a lot of ground.
Well, a lot of time to
He's
think about
New
it
York,
in the airport.
We expected fast.
But at the last part, you mentioned how the climate change means that they have to deal, the Native Americans have to deal with communities that didn't have to deal with the Native Americans before, and new issues that they don't understand. But doesn't it go the other way as well, that the Native Americans, for example, in a given area may have had to deal previously with other rural communities?
Yep.
And now they're going to have to deal with the problems of more dense populations, which they may be unfamiliar with what that means. So, you know, for example, something that's close to my heart, that the deer carry ticks, and, you know, in a dense community, that's a real problem. And so the problem goes both ways in terms of
right.
a relearning experience.
Yeah. Well, that's a good point, actually, because that's a good point. So another perspective on that, too, right, is that tribes, there's a good presentation you can find online by a guy, Jeff Mears, who's one of the directors of natural resources at the United Nations of Wisconsin, not New York. but he talks about how, with respect to climate change, actually, a lot of tribes, the urban population that they have that are in cities, the relocated folks, might move actually back onto the reservation. You know, there's reasons for talking about why that is, and that the tribal government actually isn't structured to deal with that kind of population boom. So there's also another way of addressing the nature of the concerns you're bringing up is that there's actually just a whole range of impacts that tribes are bracing themselves for, and they all affect the governance structures, I mean, like you were actually indicating, right? Because the governance structures weren't designed to handle a lot of these problems. Now, one of the things that, you know, that I was trying to make is that one of the kind of the ironies, I think, that climate change is pointing out is that for a lot of tribes, the layer of authority that they depend on as having a certain kind of purchase with the U.S. government, it's that itself that's precisely being eroded. Mm-hmm. So even though those all have sort of nefarious origins, right? Because the thing is, a lot of those things, like, I mean, treaty is a good example, right? You know, the U.S. doesn't sign treaties anymore with tribes. It won't do it so ever again. It hasn't done so for 140 years. And so the idea is that some of these sort of relics that are actually very important for native governance today, it's precisely those that are going to be eroded, so that future interactions are actually going to be ones with groups, you know, like you're mentioning, that see tribes just as citizens. And absolutely, it goes both ways. So I completely agree. Every time I present something that has sort of this native bias to it, but that's not because I don't think it goes, that's just how I talk about it. But yeah, I completely agree.
Mike?
Yeah, and the disorientation, you know, one of the, I guess, erosions that's occurring in terms of relationships is rural people in the United States and the U.S. government, and this rural white communities. And the most overt example of this is with the Keystone Pipeline, and the way that a lot of rural communities in the Ogallala Aquifer, Kansas, Oklahoma, going up to Canada border, have been fighting, utilizing what they perceived as a privileged relationship as landowners, you know, and again, you go back to the origins, yep. And we know that story. And yet they've lost this privileged relationship because it's being displaced as part of this, you know, and this is how you want to relate this to climate change is tricky, right? Because it's certainly accentuating it, which is bringing the tar sands to a gas pipe near you. But what's happened is that they've ended up, and Yes Magazine has covered this, so on the positive front, there's been peoples who never had any kind of positive relationship, certainly white communities in Oklahoma and Kansas and Nebraska and going north, with Native American groups in that area. And largely through some of the actions of the Idle No More movement in Canada, that's come down now, and the relationships that they have with some tribal governments in Idaho, I guess mainly in Idaho, because it hasn't percolated, Washington State maybe a little bit. And now they're engaged in these deliberations where they're both coming from complete unfamiliarity with each other, but they're both united against the Keystone Pipeline and sort of on behalf of interests around climate change and sustainability and resilience. And so you see a complete reconfiguration because what was previously a privileged group, again, rural landowners, are disoriented relative to the new regime because of the kinds of changes that are happening around climate change.
Right.
So this is kind of a positive scale jumping that's happening relative to the weakening of the jurisdictional frameworks that kind of kept these old relationships in place.
Yeah, no, absolutely, and that's what I think. So I tend to, so one of the things about, I think when you study something like climate change adaptation is, you know, we always tend to look at these impacts and things like that, immediately see them as negatives, right? But if you look in sort of just the notion of adaptation, right? I mean, there's numerous opportunities and so on that come from climate destabilization, right? So I think the more basic way to look at things, right, is that, like you're kind of describing, it's these, you get these new kind of sets of relationships and so on. And in some cases, I think you might get stronger deliberative bodies that work together in joint ways. But in a lot of other cases, I worry that that's not gonna happen. And actually, you know, tribal sovereignty, depending on how you define it, will actually be substantially weakened. I've got another paper where one of the things that in another kind of paper I've been working on, I talk about this notion that with respect to that climate change actually fits very neatly into the history of colonization of tribes, because in colonization of tribes in the U.S., it's hot and cold, right? You get these periods where the U.S. respects a limited form of tribal sovereignty, and you get these periods where the U.S. doesn't want anything to do with sovereignty rights. And, you know, 19th century treaties, respect for sovereignty with limits. Right after that, you get the allotment period, complete denigration of sovereignty. Then after that, you get the Indian New Deal period, right, where you get a limited respect for sovereignty. Then the termination period, complete delegitimation of sovereignty. Then we're right now, right, we're in this, what they call the modern period of federal Indian law, which is where tribes can be respected as states. You get a kind of a limited acknowledgement of sovereignty. So the problem, one of the ways of looking at the problem of colonialism is that it's sort of this hot-cold thing, right? Now, with respect to climate change, I argue that climate change actually fits quite nicely in this pattern, because it's now a challenge to sovereignty, because some of these new deliberative formations that are going to occur are with people who aren't going to respect in any way tribal sovereignty, or they're going to favor certain groups as the proper delegations for tribes and not understand the nuances of how the other delegations from tribes actually operate, right? So I think that that's something interesting to explore in the case that you mentioned, right? Because what do some of these folks that are now working with tribes, right? You know, they might be working with activists, some members of tribal governments, tribal staff, other community members. What do they think of these? You know, what do they think of these folks? Do they see them as a separate nation? Mm-hmm. Do they see them, right? And so what I think is that you're going to find, and this is just speculation, but that climate change will actually create more situations where tribes no longer have their sovereignty as a bargaining chip, no different from during the termination period or the allotment period. I mean, that's a substantial problem.
Yeah, I think that what's happening in this particular case, and I'm mentioning a positive case, because it's kind of going back to the talk about how do you distinguish between a destabilization that promotes, say, a participatory democratic view, and a destabilization that's going to undermine previous gains on a participatory
view.
So in this one, to manage a watershed requires a more multi-jurisdictional commons perspective. And it just so happens that a lot of tribes have better governance frameworks for managing multi-jurisdictional commons assets, right? So then you're learning, and I realize I can protect my ranch better under that system of governance, which I'm not necessarily understanding as respecting tribal sovereignty, but understanding the more commons jurisdictional framework. And that happens to benefit.
Well, but that's the interesting thing, though, about it, because there you get the, I actually agree, because there are, so I mean, in some of the work I have talked about, well, I would talk about positive examples of this, right, where, like, if you're talking about the case you're describing, so where people actually adopt the some aspects of the tribal system of governance because they see that it's the one that best actually fits the ecosystem, the dynamics of the ecosystem. But one of the interesting things there is that you mentioned that that wasn't a sovereignty issue, and that's interesting, right? Because for tribes, the governance system, that's what the that's the tribal notion of sovereignty, right? I mean, I think that's implied in what you're saying. That's the tribal notion of sovereignty, but then the folks who are accepting that aren't accepting it as such, right? They're accepting it as just good wisdom or, you know, a better way to do things, right?
Well, or they're entering into a new arrangement with that, you know, again, it's evolving and you don't know how it's going to turn out. I mean, but it's certainly not saying there's ideological conversions on the notion of sovereignty.
No, exactly. And what's funny about that, and this is what's always been fairly difficult for me, is that in a lot of ways, these sorts of arrangements that you're talking about, this is what people have been fighting for a long time in Indian country. They wanted to have these better relationships where there was respect for actual tribal systems of governance, and not just respect for a treaty right or a trust relationship or something like that. So that in this sense, climate change is going to, we're actually going to see what might happen, but you're going to actually have cases, and I know about other ones too, like what you're talking about, that are actually really encouraging, and that are better.
Should we seize that moment to I don't know, allow some of the students, I know, must have papers they have to write and everything. But you seem to have a captive audience here. Are there any further, a few more questions in common, and then we could, let's go with Phoebe.
Okay, I just wanted to ask, that was a great talk, thank you. If you have any, like, suggestions or guidelines of how to combat these worries that are coming up, like, is it mostly about educating these parties and that are going to have to be respecting tribal sovereignty, is it?
Yeah, exactly. So I've got some different ideas. Like I have an article called Justice Forward. I have an article called On the Role of Traditional Ecological Knowledge as a Collaborative Concept. And I, in those papers and some other ones I'm working on, I don't necessarily say that it's not that it's more education that's needed, but that especially non-native people, and here right I'm talking from sort of my bias these issues, but that non-native people need to rethink how they understand certain concepts, right? So on the paper about traditional ecological knowledge, that's a common concept that you see used in deliberative contexts with tribes, like in the cases that you're talking about, like indigenous knowledge, traditional ecological knowledge, right? And I talk about if people are to have healthy collaborative relationships, they should never understand that term, how it's typically understood, and then I give some ideas for how I think they understand it. But then I also say that I'm also fairly dubious that a lot of non-native folks are ever going to get to that point anytime soon. And not because of any kind of, my view is actually not because non-native people won't grasp, you know, some sort of, you know, deep wisdom that tribes have, but that they collaborate differently. They understand the pragmatics of language very differently within deliberative contexts. So a lot of what I do is try to understand how the pragmatics of language work and suggest ways that in a climate change scenario that language would have to be used in certain ways in order for tribes to be not in positions where they're exploited, to not be in positions where they're colonized. So yeah, that's general. I can send you some papers and things like that. Yeah.
Yeah,
well, just what kind of ways, like, you talk about pragmatics and language.
Yeah.
How it would,
yeah. So I'll send you, so I've got like these, so take like a notion like traditional knowledge, right? So indigenous knowledge, I think is probably the easiest example to understand. So if you look about how it's used in the English language, I think this goes back to the point you were making, right? Is that a lot of collaborators who work with tribes, they don't acknowledge the fact that native people don't use the term indigenous knowledge among themselves. Like, you don't tell your grandpa, you know, show me some indigenous knowledge or something like that, right? It's an English language term that's meant to refer to something that and not in any mystical sense, right? It's just that native people didn't originally speak English, so things that they talk about that belong to their culture don't necessarily have, you know, reference points in the English language. And so in one of my studies, I showed that in a number of English language definitions of traditional knowledge, that in the language itself, it tends to erase native agency in deliberative context, right? So for example, and there's other examples, but this is, I think, fairly easy one, the little time that I have now. A lot of articulations in English of indigenous knowledge treat it as a set of data, as a set of data that differs from science. And when it's articulated as a set of data, it suggests that Western scientists, non-native scientists, can use it without active collaboration with tribes, right? So there the idea is that in how people use language, it's always suggesting certain realities and how people understand the other's role within deliberative contexts, so that people first actually have to step back and say, okay, I didn't even realize the concept could do that. Once they realize the concept could do that, then they actually have to look at how native people have articulated the concept in English as well, right? And I contrast native conceptions of that concept as well, where it's defined much, much differently. So that's, I think, an example.
Okay, our last question.
I visited Quebec this summer, and Quebecois have a first Nations movement.
Yes.
And I'm just wondering, they seem to be going the direction of tourism and entrepreneurial spirit to gain a certain clout with the Canadian government. Do you find that the problem with American indigenous groups, unless they gain economic power, they're not recognized as being substantial? You see the casinos in Connecticut and now in New York. What's your view of that in the Michigan case?
It's interesting because, I mean, like for like the tribe I'm enrolled in, it's actually a Michigan tribe, but we're in Oklahoma now because we got removed. And so in the case of my tribe, actually, I think, can't quote me on this, but it's easy to look up online. I think this year we generated about $400 million in economy. I mean, it's numerous things. We own the bank, we own a utility, we sort of are the main government actually in that area that provides, I think, far better services than the state of Oklahoma does to Indians and non-Indians, right? And there's a pretty active debate going on with that I wish more non-Native people got into it in a different way than they typically do, right? About what actually the significance of this economic development is for the sorts of values that a lot of Native community members actually have, right? And so there's a lot of cases about what's the relationship between economic development in a Western sense, how does that relate to Indigenous sovereignty? How do you balance the different ways of doing things? So I actually feel strongly that, and I think this ties into literature that Carol I know has worked on as well, but maybe in different contexts. That I do think that Native people can engage in businesses and economic enterprises very, very differently and with very, very different incentives than the communities that surround them, right? So oftentimes the purpose of the business is for sharing and not per capita payments, right? Because a lot of people think that the dominant model in Indian country for business is per capita payments to tribal members. Only a few tribes actually use per capita payments. A lot of them reinvest into the infrastructure. But I think that the businesses, through different understandings of the relationship between the business and the community member, can actually achieve forms of tribal sovereignty. The problem is that you see the typical colonial tensions putting stress on that, right? So for example, democratically elected tribal governments who might have relied on federal grants or other investors to start the businesses, they feel beholden to show that they're getting the results that those investors or supporters want, which are oftentimes employment numbers or things like that. Those people get stressed out and they often do things that I disagree with, I think are antithetical to tribal concerns. So I do agree that economic development, well actually you didn't express a view on this, but my view is that economic development is key, but we actually need to think of economic development in terms of these indigenous models of doing business, and ones that are not actually new ideas. Indigenous people have traded in commercial enterprises for thousands of years, right, with other cultures and so on. So, yeah, that's
terrific. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks for having me.